hello. It's far too hard to be doing that. By some miracle, I read 10 books in September. Who is she? Hello, welcome back. My name is Meekela. This is Meekela Reads. I live here, and I'm here today to tell you about the 10 books I read in September. I cannot stress to you how good a reading month September was. I do this every time. When I'm in a reading slump, I forget that other forms of reading exist. So a large portion of today's books I did actually listen to, but I still read them. It's still reading. And so we're going to talk about them today. But first, we are going to hear a small word for the sponsor of today's video, analuisany, who you are all, I'm sure, very familiar with. Analuisany are a jewelry brand who I really, really love partnering with. Not only is their jewelry just such high quality, really, it's quite durable given some of the stuff I've put it through. It's also incredibly sustainable. They are climate certified, being water and carbon neutral, and they use recycled materials where possible. We're doing things a bit different today. We're going to talk about how some of the pieces that I've already talked to you about before have actually stood up to that quality that I continue to talk about. Like I said, I have not been the kindest to my pieces, and when you purchase your own analuisany jewelry, I really do recommend that you treat it right and take care of it, but I just wanted to show you through the Meekela testing how it's fared. I will start by telling you about some of the pieces that I literally wear every single day. Probably the most worn, we have the Celeste earrings. I would say these earrings are the pair that I have worn the most. I do wear them in the shower, and I don't recommend that you do that because I did actually lose one of the little cubic zirconias out of it, but I still continue to wear them every single day, unless I swap them out for the Sea Art paperclip earrings. One of the things that I really enjoy about analuisany in general is that the pieces are so versatile and you can genuinely wear them anywhere that you are. I wore the Missanti necklace with my beautiful fairy princess rainbow dress to a wedding, and it was perfect, but I've also worn that necklace to work. You can change it up. There are no rules here. The second most worn piece that I have is actually the Zodiac necklace. They no longer sell these ones, unfortunately, but they do have a new Zodiac collection that has just come out. I have worn this necklace almost every single day for the past year. My bird has regularly attacked the chain. I've worn it swimming. I've worn it again in the shower. Not great. And it is still looking brand new. So if that doesn't tell you the quality of these pieces, I do not know what does. So that's just like a little update. And if you would like to purchase some jewelry of your own, head over to analuisany's website. I've left the link in the description down below, and you can use my code MEEKELAREADS20 to get 20% off of your order at any time, anytime. And let's continue on with the video and talk about the books that I read in September. September really does feel like it was more than a month ago. The first book I read in September, I did listen to it, but I own the book, is Yellowface by Rebecca Kwong. We started off strong. Rebecca Kwong is also known as R.F. Kwong, who is the very well-known author of the Poppy War trilogy and Babel, and now Yellowface. And I just want to start off by talking about R.F. Kwong for a little bit, because she is a year younger than me. She's 27. She has three now best-selling books in the industry, is writing her fourth book, and completing her PhD at the same time. That is wild. I admire her so much. How does she do it? She wrote this in like the height of the spicy cough lockdowns, where everyone was just going a little bit stir crazy, a little bit cabin fevery. She does sort of say that she wrote this book to kind of channel all of that energy into something, and it shows. This book was a wild ride from start to finish in the mind of someone who is quite possibly just unhinged. We follow June, who is a budding author. She's trying to make it in the industry. And we open the book as she and her closest friend, who is also an author, but actually is succeeding quite well in the industry, suddenly dies. And our main girl, June, steals the unfinished manuscript of her friend Athena, takes it home with her, and proceeds to write and publish the book herself. And that is what we follow in this story. There's a lot of nods to the publishing industry that Rebecca Kwong has put in there. Though I don't know a whole lot about the publishing industry, I can appreciate quite a lot of it. And I didn't need to know about all of the things to keep on top of the book. The author uses this like really quite unhinged, unreliable, unlikable narrator to highlight all of the stuff that does happen in the publishing industry to this day, or as it stands. Or as I think it stands, because I don't actually know. I'm not, again, not up on what happens in the publishing industry, but there was one quote that I really liked, and it's at the very start of the book, and it really just set the tone for the whole rest of it. It says, "But now I see, author efforts have nothing to do with the book's success. Bestsellers are chosen." And I haven't been able to stop thinking about that quote because it keeps bouncing around in my brain, and I think about all of the books that are out there that are amazing that we just don't know about because the market is so oversaturated with books and authors that are, to be honest, sometimes a bit overhyped and underdeliver somewhat. I only have so much time in my life to read. And the other thing I noticed is that none of the characters are all good or all bad. They all had like differing perspectives of each other. They all had positive parts and negative parts. I didn't like a single character completely in this book, but this is in fact the first book where I haven't liked any of the characters, haven't been overly invested or know a lot about the context or the content of the plot, and still was so invested and really quite eager to figure out what happens like in the book. And I think that does kind of speak a fair bit to how Rebecca Kwong is able to write and how she's able to suck people in the way that she does. I'm really glad I gave this a go after the puppy war. I'm really hoping that I like Babel, but I haven't read it yet. I think with this one, you either love it or you hate it. So if you are gonna read it, just give it a good hot go. See where you land. After that, I listened to Harrow the Ninth, which is the sequel to Gideon the Ninth, which I also listened to earlier this year. Gideon and Harrow the Ninth both sit within this weird genre blend of sci-fi, fantasy, dystopian that I still cannot pull apart for the life of me. Without giving too much away about the plot of the first book, Harrow the Ninth picks up pretty close after where we finish in Gideon the Ninth. However, we are now reading from Harrowhawk's perspective. We also get introduced to an entirely new cast of characters and an entirely new level of powers and entirely different levels of this political world system and how it works. It was just as confusing as Gideon the Ninth. I didn't know until literally halfway through the book where I was and who was who. There's also some time jumps and skips that I was not entirely sure what was happening for those either until pretty much right at the end of the book. And realistically, I think a lot of that comes down to the fact that I listened to it and didn't read it, and I stand by the fact that I think I probably should just read this series rather than listen to it because my spicy brain misses too many things. I did like Harrow the Ninth. It definitely built on the world. The stakes were raised tenfold. All the powers were raised tenfold. It was quite a good development. I did enjoy it, and I think that the mystery in the arc of the story continues because there's still things from the first book that haven't been entirely answered in the second book yet, but I probably won't be finishing the series. And that's purely because they're incredibly dense books. There is so much going on. I would have to reread both the first and the second book if I was going to continue the series, and I just don't have time for that. It's a very well-loved series, and if you like the three genres, you'll probably like it. I liked it. It just was a lot for my burnt out brain to focus on. We then did a bit of a 180 and we flipped to contemporary romance as a genre, and I listened to The No Show by Beth O'Leary. I've read her books before. I read The Road Trip. I listened to that one, and that was like a 3 to 3.5 star read. But then I read The Switch by her, and I did that as a buddy read with Shani from Shani and Books. And that was a vast improvement on the reading experience because I got to actually share my thoughts with someone else in real time. The No Show, it was interesting. It's a multi-point of view story. We follow three women and their relationships with this one man, Joseph Carter. So we follow Siobhan, Miranda, and Jane. We open the book with all three of them being stood up by Joseph Carter on Valentine's Day. Overall, the theme of the book was really interesting. I was definitely manipulated as the reader to think exactly what the author wanted me to think, but I did guess probably one of the bigger twist elements in it quite early on, and ultimately the fact that I'd guessed the thing that happened really lessened the impact of the end of the book. In the end, I actually quite enjoyed listening to this book. The way that the three stories were told throughout and how they weaved together was quite well done. It didn't feel clunky, it didn't feel out of place. I knew who was talking when they were talking. What really stood out was actually how it all sort of wrapped up at the end, because I think when you have multi POV storylines and then authors try to bring that together, sometimes it doesn't land, but this one did, and it did very well. Although I guessed some of what the end twist stuff was, there were still things that I had no idea were coming. In hindsight, I probably should have, but it was still a fun experience in that sense. And then we rolled on with the theme of just some easy to consume listening books. And that is no different for the next book because I listened to The Lesbiana's Guide to Catholic School. This is by Sonora Reyes, and it is a young adult coming of age, queer, not quite romance story. Our narrator in this is Yemilette, and she is at the start of the book outed by her ex-best friend as being a lesbian to her school without her wanting that to come out, obviously. Moves to the local Catholic school where almost everybody is white. She is in the lower minority of being a person of color at this school. She is also in the even lower minority of being a queer person at this school. And so to keep under the radar, she has to pretend to be straight. That gets complicated when she starts to fall for the only other openly lesbian girl at the school. Shenanigans ensued. This was definitely more of a YA novel, but I still had mostly a good time. There were parts that I didn't enjoy, and that was mostly around just being infuriated by Yamilet. To be honest, she was so caught up in her own secrets and her own worries and her own issues that she didn't realize the impact that had on other people around her and how that sucked other people in to all the drama in like more than one way. But I do have to rein it in because she is a young adult, she's still a teenager, and I'm coming at this with an adult brain that is hopefully fully formed, and I cannot expect her to have this brain because she is in fact still in high school. Another thing that made me so ragey while reading this is just, I know that it's fiction, but the level of racism in here is just wild. And it made me genuinely quite angry. And then I had to like sit down and be like, it's a book. But then at the same time, like it's actually reflecting a lot of the ongoing racism that occurs daily in society. And it just makes me mad. Books like this are important to depict the disparity that people of color and queer communities and other minorities experience day in and day out. Overall, it was really quite fun to listen to. If you like young adult books, if you like coming of age, if you like a good queer, heartwarming story, give it a go. And then I read a whole bunch of books as a part of the video I released last week, and that is a bunch of cozy fantasy books. You already know about them if you've watched that video. If you want some real-time reactions, there was some tears, there was some laughter, check it out. I think I've left it here somewhere. But first, I read Mooncakes. This is a witchy romance coming of age graphic novel that has a phenomenal amount of representation. We love it. We love the diversity. We love to see it. One of our main characters is Nova. She is a witch. She works with her gay grandmothers at a bookstore that also sells potions and does witchy things, like helping the neighborhood out with all of their supernatural qualms. The second main character is Tam, who is in fact a shapeshifter, and Tam is a transgender person as well. Like I said, love the representation in this book. The only downfall is that the characters did feel quite two-dimensional in the sense that at the start of the graphic novel, we just jumped straight into their relationship and it felt as though there was potentially like another book before it that I missed that had all of the backstory and development of the characters. And it was just this assumed friendship. The other thing is that like the dialogue felt a little bit forced and a bit cringy at the beginning, but I stopped caring towards the end because I fell into the story. Hands down, favorite characters were the grandmothers. I feel like their characters had kind of the implication that their story was long and so we weren't gonna get all of it. But I guess from the general archetype and the general things that we saw them do, their characters really came through a lot more well-rounded and robust than the main characters did. The story itself was quite lovely though. It really had a lot of nods to finding your place when the people that you look up to or your parents or your relationships have changed to not be what you expected them to be or maybe what they were before. So that was Mooncakes. It was lovely and cozy. No, I take it back. My favorite character was Cousin Terry the Pigeon. I would love a whole graphic novel of Cousin Terry the Pigeon and the spirit animals. Please and thank you. Next. It took me nearly a month, but I read Tress of the Emerald Sea by Brendan Sanderson. Though there were stakes, though there was some gore and some fighting, I still very much classify it as a cozy fantasy. It was a lovely story that centers on our main character Tress, whose name is actually Glorf, but we call her Tress, who sets off from her tiny deserted isolated island in the middle of an emerald sea of spores that turn into giant vines when they're touched by water, to save the man that she loves, who has been captured by an evil sorceress on the other side of the oceans. That is the story, like the plot of the book, but it's so much more than that. Essentially, Tress also has this journey of self-discovery, of discovering different friendships and exploring how the people in our lives can help us to better ourselves, can help us to discover ourselves. There's just so many whimsical elements to the story that were just really lovely. I've said it before, I'll say it again, Brendan Sanderson's writing continues to blow me away. Incredibly compatible, he and I, author and reader. I think the thing that really stood out was the fact that he was able to keep the story both equally heartwarming and light, but also serious and quite like worldly, with nods to our own society, with some fourth wall breaks in there. But he did that with such simple words. Like, the writing isn't lyrical, it's not flowery, it's not hard to read. It was simple, but it was so impactful. A really good example is the fact that there is a character in this you don't really hear from or know about, and he gets one paragraph, and I was so invested in his life and what he does and who he is as a character. One paragraph and that's it. It's just so nice to have a book that is both impactful, emotionally driving, but easy to read. There were so many good quotes in the book. I wasn't gonna annotate it when I picked it up and read it, but I had to. Again, I did guess the twist quite early on, but there was enough other things happening and other twists and turns that it really didn't matter. It was still a really good time either way. This is up there, probably with some new favorites. I'm not gonna call it too early, but it could be. Then, technically, the last books I read in September was the entirety of The Tea Dragon Society by Kay O'Neill, which includes The Tea Dragon Society, The Tea Dragon Festival, and The Tea Dragon Tapestry. And I know that there's three of them, but I just want there to be more. I am gonna jump the gun and say is among my new favorite books that I've ever read. It's a graphic novel series. In the first one, we follow Greta, who is a blacksmith's daughter. She's apprenticing to be a blacksmith, and she stumbles upon the tea dragon keepers in her village, in her town, and she gets taken on to learn the art of caring and taking care for the tea dragons. The tea dragons are these little dragons that grow tea leaves on their bodies. Not only are they adorable little tea dragons that grow tea leaves on their bodies, when you drink the tea, you see the shared memories that you have and that the tea dragon has had. You get to experience the past. The amount of money that I would give, insurmountable. Reading these really gave me that same sense of cozy, happy, my soul has been nourished feeling as A Psalm for the Wild Build did. So I'm so glad that I've read these finally. It took me a long time to get them. It was an ordeal to get them, but I have them and I love them and I will cherish them forever. The second one, The Tea Dragon Festival, we actually take a step back in time and we explore some different characters in a different village where everyone takes care of the tea dragon. There's some crossover with some characters from The Tea Dragon Society, but we follow Rin, who is a non-binary character, and Rin finds a sleeping dragon that's not a tea dragon as they investigate this weird, strange phenomenon that keeps happening to people in the town where they just fall asleep for a really long period of time. And then the third one, The Tea Dragon Tapestry, it brings both of the stories together in a really, really beautiful way and wraps it all up, and it makes you just feel so complete. The art style continues to blow me away. Kay O'Neill is now my new favorite graphic novelist, but I think one of the things that I really appreciate, and I didn't realize that I now appreciate this, having read many graphic novels recently, is that we have such well-rounded characters. We have a really cohesive and understandable storyline within a really short amount of pages. There's so much of the story and the emotion that's conveyed through the art style that I think can be hit and miss sometimes with graphic novels, and I think Kay O'Neill did that very, very well. So, Tea Dragon Society, 10 out of 10 recommend. Everyone should read this. I'm sorry if you know me personally, you will be forced to read this. And finally, technically I didn't finish this in September, I finished it in October, but it fits for me to talk about it now. It was The Cybernetic Tea Shop. This is by Meredith Katz. It is a very short 110 page dual perspective cozy sci-fi slash dystopian story. We follow Clara, who is like a mechanic repair person, and we also follow Sally, who owns a tea shop. Sally is an AI robot and she has been running this tea shop for couple hundred years at this point. We follow both characters, their paths cross, and we actually cover quite a lot of ground in the 110 pages. I think that is slightly at fault of the book though, because we follow a lot of content in the story and there's a lot of things that happen and a lot of things that are spoken about, but the characters don't have a whole lot of depth to them, and I feel like we could really have done with fleshing them out a little bit more and a little bit more story to do that with. I said it in the vlog as well, but the themes and the plot for this are quite reminiscent of a cross between like Legends and Lattes and Before the Coffee Gets Cold, but again without that really robust emotional connection and impact that the other two had. So it's like a fun little short cozy sci-fi-ish book. If that's something that you're interested in, there's some lovely queer moments in there. There's a lot of nods to like racism against the AI robots that's kind of reflective of the current society. And look, if you read it, you might pick it up and find some more of the things about like the inner meanings of the book, because I read it when I was tired and burnt out. I had just come off the back of reading Tress of the Emerald Sea and The Tea Dragon Society, so it had a high bar to live up to, and that probably wasn't entirely fair. So, after all that, I'm losing my voice. Those are all the books I read in September. Thanks for coming along. It really doesn't need any more words than that. I've said a lot of words already. Don't forget to check out Analuisa. If you have not already, link is in the description. Again, you can use my code meekelareads20 to get 20% off of your order at any time. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you're having a fantastic day or night or whatever time it is we are in the world, and I will see you next week. Definitely. Goodbye.